My name is Nancy Lin. I'm a medical oncologist at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute in Boston, Massachusetts, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the next installment of our 10th annual Embrace Metastatic Breast Cancer Forum. Before we start, I wanted to just do a couple of housekeeping items. If you have questions throughout the session, you can enter them in the Q&A button, which is located on the bottom right of your Zoom screen. All participants are muted during the discussion, and then there will be a Q&A at the end. And so you can enter questions at any time throughout the program. Next slide. The last installment of our 2021-2022 virtual forum series will happen on March 29th. And this is a special session, which will be led by Dr. Otto Metzger on research and treatment for metastatic lobular breast cancer. And I hope that you can join us. So before we move on, I wanted to just introduce Hannah Earle. Hannah has been living with metastatic breast cancer since September 2018. And has been receiving treatment on a clinical trial since then. She was originally diagnosed with early stage breast cancer in 2016 when she was 31 and has been with Dana-Farber since then. She lives in New Hampshire with her two children and husband. And fortunately for us, Hannah has recently joined our Embrace Patient Advisory Council. Hannah will be introducing Dr. Bober and moderating the Q&A session. And I'm so glad that all of you could join and hope that you find this session useful and informative. Okay, take it away, Hannah.
Dr. Lin. Hi, I'm so excited to be here and I welcome everyone. I'd like to introduce Dr. Bober to you. Dr. Bober is the founder and director of sexual health program at Dana-Farber. She's a senior psychologist and associate professor of psychiatry at Harvard Medical School. Dr. Bober will speak for about 45 minutes about a half an hour. The whole session might be about 45 minutes to an hour. Throughout the program, you can leave questions in the Q&A box, and we will break here and there for some questions during the presentation, and then we'll have some Q&A at the end as well. Remember, you can always submit the Q&A during that 30-minute period that she's speaking, or afterwards, and then this presentation will be posted after it's completed.
Thank you, Hannah. Is this a good time to get started? Okay, well, it's a pleasure to be here with all of you today. I just wanna say it's really an honor to be speaking with you in the context of the Embrace program. And I really hope that we'll be able to speak frankly about sexual health and what that means to live with breast cancer and think about sexual recovery at the same time. I have this first slide up because we live in a pretty sex-focused culture, and we live in a kind of a crazy culture when it comes to thinking about sexual health and breast cancer from my point of view, because it really does not reflect the real experience that most women have around what it even means to feel or be sexy or have a sense of recovery around sexual health. It's often very sort of superficial and really doesn't get at most women's actual experience. The fact is, in the context of living with advanced disease, of living with breast cancer, we know that sexual function is one of the first aspects of life that is disrupted and often stays disrupted to some degree for a long time. We also know that, unfortunately, most women are simply not prepared for dealing with many of the sort of long-term changes, and whether that's about sexual function or whether that's about body image or the experience of interpersonal connection and intimacy. And, you know, the fact is it's complicated. This isn't something that is simple because it often involves various aspects of our health and well-being. So as many of you know from your experience, you know, every type of treatment that we bring to bear, whether that's starting with surgery or not, radiation, chemotherapy, hormone therapy, experimental therapies, actually all have the potential to impact sexual function over time. We also know, let me just sort of step back and say that when we talk about sexual health and sexual function, sometimes people have assumptions that it's just about sexual activity. And I really want to clarify that from my perspective, we are talking about an experience that is much bigger than just physical activity. That's also about our experience of ourselves, our thoughts, our beliefs about body image, about our roles and our relationships. That's really as much a psychological and a relational concept as it is physical. And there are really a very wide range of normal functions. There is a wide range of normal functions. So this is to say that I am not coming from the perspective of what is a healthy sexual function, but more from the perspective that for each woman, it's important to figure out what is different or what is bothersome or what is disrupted for you. And then to be able to figure out what a kind of a reasonable roadmap or a kind of activity plan would be in order to be able to recover what's important for you. So this is to say that if there are changes that are bothersome or just distressing in any way, I would say this aspect of life deserves attention. It's just as important as any other aspect of quality of life. And again, really thinking about this both as much from a physical perspective as also sort of emotional and psychological and relational. So, you know, I definitely want to take some time to talk about some of the common sexual side effects that women often live with over many years. Those include changes in response and arousal. There may be changes in orgasm, certainly in terms of vaginal health, and we'll talk about that, vaginal dryness. Pain with or without sexual activity, and that's really important because whether someone is sexually active or not, there may be changes in vaginal health that need to be addressed. And then we can also talk a little bit about a kind of broad category that often women struggle with around desire or motivation. It is so common that women talk about sort of having loss of desire, loss of intimacy, and similarly changes around just sense of integrity and body image. So those are some of the topics that we'll touch on today. I also really want to kind of emphasize that the framework or perspective that we use certainly at the Dana-Farber and that I really think about with the folks that I work with is that we take what we call a biopsychosocial perspective. Again, meaning that we're going to sort of look at sexual activity and sexual health at the kind of intersection of changes that are physical, changes that may be personal or psychological, and changes that may often happen in a relationship, right? When roles change, when expectations change, often couples aren't sure how to even talk about some of these changes. And there may be sort of shifts in some of those kind of relationship dynamics. And we really need to, I think, appreciate that sexuality is not always driven by only one factor, but may really well be at the intersection of multiple factors. Also really wanna kind of appreciate that we need to be proactive. When we think about sexual health and sexual recovery, we know that sexual problems related to cancer treatment often do not self-resolve. That means that they do not tend to get better on their own. And we also know that when women are struggling with changes in sexual function, it's not just distressing, but it actually tracks with anxiety, it tracks with low self-esteem, and it tracks with relationship distress. Relationships can be stressed over this topic. So from my perspective, it's really important to emphasize the need to both get educated and to advocate and to be really proactive about this aspect of our care, just like any other. So I think in terms of our starting point, I'm going to encourage everybody today to sort of be thinking as we go through this kind of webinar, what are my goals? You know, what are the things that are important to me? What do I want? Or from a relationship perspective, what do we want? What is it that I'm hoping for? And to be able to start thinking about realistic next steps as we really, again, with the goal or intention of creating a roadmap to recovery. And that's going to look, you know, potentially different for each person. So I also will kind of comment as a prologue that especially when we are thinking about metastatic cancer and really sort of living with cancer over time, I appreciate that there's a lot going on and many of us are balancing many stressors simultaneously. And when that happens, it's not uncommon to tune out in a way from what's going on around sexuality and intimacy. But what happens is that these sort of notions of distraction and avoidance, which are essentially strategies to cope with distress, can really become a habit. And it can really become something that that whether we're conscious about it or not, we end up kind of avoiding. And what I would invite us to consider is that distraction and avoidance can be useful in the short term, but in the long term, one, it takes a lot of energy, and two, it may not be helpful over time. So again, thinking about the ways in which often both as an individual and as a couple, we often can kind of tune out from this aspect of our experience. It's also important to be able to tune in to figure out what are the issues that we need to work on and where can I get started in terms of making active steps to allow us to make things better. So I'm going to start with talking about vaginal health, because I think that this is something that all women need to really be aware of and really need to consider, especially when we are living with cancer and on active treatments over time. We know that any kind of treatment that puts us into menopause long-term over time, that puts us into menopause in an intensified sort of way, or menopause at an early stage in life before we would have gone into menopause naturally, any kind of therapy that really sort of depletes estrogen is going to have an impact on what we call a genito-urinary symptoms of menopause. So that means from a vaginal health perspective that, you know, the vaginal tissue previously, which sort of thrives on estrogen, can lose elasticity, can lose some stretch, can lose blood flow. And this can really have an impact on both not just sexual function, but general health and well-being, meaning that women may have itching, burning, dryness with or without sexual activity. Women may also have urinary symptoms. This is very common. And often we don't even make the connection that UTIs or frequency or urgency are actually connected to changes in estrogen levels. There are also changes to the external tissue, the vulvar tissue, the vulva, which can again become dry or itchy or uncomfortable. We also lose testosterone. And all of these together can make life, you know, as we know, anywhere between uncomfortable and miserable, depending on how we're managing menopause. And I think very directly, we need to think about improving vaginal health. And this is because we want to be able to have women have a GYN exam comfortably, obviously related to sexual function, but not only about sexual function. I will say, I just want to make sure that's the next slide. I will say that when it comes to sexual function and sexual activity, whether that is for oneself or with a partner, when there is dryness, when there is discomfort in terms of vaginal health because of, again, lack of blood flow and lack of moisture, we also know that that very quickly becomes related to an avoidance of sexual activity. You know, often women experience low desire as a stressor, right? It may be a stressor in a relationship. It may be a stressor around dating. But when we start to really sort of do a little bit of assessment and question, we realize that women often have had an experience around sexual activity that is uncomfortable or painful. Very quickly, anybody who's had uncomfortable or painful sex doesn't want to repeat that experience. That makes sense. We want to avoid that. We want to do everything we can to not repeat that. At the very physical level, at the pelvic floor level, our body says, no thanks, right? We want those muscles start to self-guard. And again, low desire very quickly comes into play. So I think that we'll talk about low desire and some strategies around that. But first and foremost, we need to make sure that vulvovaginal health is good. We need to make sure that vaginal health is restored if it is not intact right now. So that means that we have to think very concretely about helping women restore moisture to that tissue, helping get stretch back to that tissue and increase capacity. And we need to get blood flow to that tissue. We need to think about exercise and what we need to do to get blood flowing the way we think about general health and well-being for our whole body. Very specifically, I think women need to know what they need to know about restoring moisture and managing dryness. Lots of times women hear about using a lubricant. That's all they hear. I think it's really important to get educated about the types of products that are specifically helpful. There are vaginal moisturizers that are different than vaginal lubricants. Vaginal lubricants essentially make the surface of the skin slick, which can be very helpful for any kind of sexual activity, but they don't hold water in the tissue. So for anyone who is on any kind of ongoing treatment in which there is estrogen deprivation, it's really important to make sure that the vagina is healthy, getting the kind of moisture it needs. Typically, we think about using a moisturizer anywhere between 3 and 5 times a week or really as needed. And moisturizers essentially adhere to that tissue, hold water in the tissue, really no different than using a moisturizer on our face before we go to bed at night or on our hands or our body in the wintertime, except for vaginal moisturizers are really formulated for that sort of more sensitive vaginal tissue. I know we certainly have a good teaching sheet about products, which you can access through the website, I think on the Embrace program and certainly through the Survivorship program and the Sexual Health program as well. Very important to be aware of quality of moisturizer. Want to make sure that we use something water-based or water and silicone-based. Want to stay away from moisturizers that are going to actually wick moisture away from that tissue, but hopefully something as simple a product as possible, staying away from something that will be either irritating, gimmicky, like a warming gel, something that is really going to be as healthy for that sort of more fragile tissue as possible. Similarly, want to use a good lubricant. I advise people again to sort of do the homework in terms of quality of lubricants, staying away again, perfumes, parabens. And then it's really important to make sure that we're thinking about that vulvar tissue, internal and externally. We need to moisturize, can use something as simple as pure coconut oil for external moisture, or a vaginal moisture that a moisturizer that like a gel or cream-based moisturizer that can be used either inside or outside. Sometimes I sort of have this note here. Sometimes women use panty liners, right? We use them very regularly. They can wick moisture away from that vaginal tissue. So just really sort of being aware, if you're using a panty liner, you may want to use a sealant, something like Desitin, to make sure that you're not wicking moisture away from the vaginal tissue. I'm not going to speak in any great detail about the use of local vaginal hormones, something like DHEA or vaginal estrogen, but I will just say that if vaginal dryness is very significant and non-hormonal moisturizers are not effective or not working, really important to speak with your oncology team about the possibility of using a small amount of a local vaginal estrogen or DHEA in order to get that tissue healthier, in order so we may be able to switch back to a non-hormonal moisturizer. But we know that vaginal dryness does not get better by itself, and that it's really important to find a regimen that works for you and that is effective over time. Okay, so switching gears from talking about vaginal dryness, I want to put a very strong plug in for learning and improving health of the pelvic floor. If anything, women hear about vaginal dryness and may try a lubricant or even a moisturizer, find that sexual activity is still painful, and feel frustrated and give up. Often this is because what we don't realize is that when over time there's some atrophy to that tissue and the pelvic floor muscles get very tight and start to self-guard in order to sort of protect us from pain, it's not enough just to moisturize the tissue. We really need to improve the health of the pelvic floor muscles, which are really like a sling of a sling of muscles, like a basket weave, really, that go across the entire pelvic floor. And when those muscles are too tight or are essentially over-engaged, when we sort of lose our potential to flexibly keep them relaxed when they need to be relaxed and toned when we want them to be toned, this can be a real problem when it comes to comfort and pleasure. So I understand that folks have learned a little bit about pelvic floor work and other previous Embrace programs. I just want to say that we are incredibly lucky to work with some of the best pelvic floor physical therapists in the country here in the Boston area. Pelvic floor physical therapy is its own particular specialization within physical therapy. And it's really important to learn the exercises and have access to some of those strategies that allow women to, again, learn how to, one, identify what's happening in the pelvic floor, and then be able to learn to relax those muscles as needed. So number of different modalities sort of within pelvic floor rehab that we use all the time. Women are able to learn how to use what we call a set of vaginal dilators. As you can see a picture on the screen, these are essentially a set of cylinders that are gradated in size to help women by themselves, for themselves, gently start to increase capacity and stretch that tissue. This is just as relevant for women after breast cancer as or women living with breast cancer as any other kind of cancer treatment where there has been vaginal atrophy. So it's not only for women, for example, who have had pelvic radiation. We also know that there are a number of exercises you can do at home. This isn't only something that you need to go to a PT for. Lots of great YouTube videos, actually, since the pandemic, made by pelvic floor therapists on YouTube, now helping women learn about what you can do at home to relax those pelvic floor muscles. So really important part of rehabilitation. And we'll also say that it is critically important to also think about exercise for that tissue. So in the same way that we very regularly talk with men about supporting blood flow for, you know, penile health after prostate cancer, we really need to talk about supporting blood flow for women after cancer as well. So that means that anything we can do to increase genital blood flow, to get some clitoral stimulation that feels pleasurable, also means we're getting some good blood flow to that tissue. We feel very strongly in the sexual health program that vibrators are not just sex toys, but they're actually therapeutic for women. So anything we can do, again, to sort of help women feel comfortable experimenting with them, for themselves, with themselves, using either sort of self-touch manually or using a vibrator can be very helpful. It is both helpful for increasing pleasure, but also again for sort of getting that tissue healthier and reducing atrophy. So I'm going to stop here for a sec and switch gears. But before I do that, I'm going to have a quick look in the, we'll sort of check in, I guess, with Hannah. Do we have any questions or, oh, I see in the chat box.
You know, a couple of people were wondering if we could get a list of, information or recommendations for moisturizer or lube, products that you would recommend, and then probably where we could get them.
Okay, so happy to just give a couple of thoughts in the context of this webinar with you now, and we can also sort of get our teaching sheet, which we've put together to the program. I would say that the best over-the-counter moisturizing products right now that we have that are very good are hyaluronic acid-based products. Hyaluronic-based products have been used by dermatology companies for many years and most recently have been harnessed to helping women with vaginal tissue after menopause. There are a number of products that are both like a gel or like a suppository, Hylogen, Gynotroph, Good Clean Love makes a moisturizer that is hyaluronic based. We actually sell Hylogen through the Friends Boutique at the Dana-Farber. That's also something you can purchase online as well as in the store. But I would say any of the hyaluronic based products are excellent. I also think that in terms of lubricant, very good products. Again, Good Clean Love is an excellent product. I think what's important is to try to pick something that is as natural as possible with as few kind of irritating extra chemicals as possible. We sell lubricants that are very good quality through the Friends Boutique, which you can access in person or online as well. So not selling products, but just to say that it is important to pick something that's good quality because it makes a difference. And I would really strongly caution people about using products that like are advertised as sort of warming gels or something that sort of has a kind of a irritating product, because what might be kind of warming or billed as being kind of arousing and for many women after menopause can really feel horrible and quite irritating and painful. So sticking with something less gimmicky and more simple is better. Hannah, any other questions on that note?
That was it so far on this topic, okay. But I just wanted to let everybody know that we're going to find a way to post a list of products and where to get them on the website when we get this presentation posted as well. So.
Perfect. Great. Glad to hear it. Okay. So I am going to switch gears from the mechanics, really to thinking about sexual health, again, from a kind of a bigger picture point of view, because I think that, again, the mechanics are super important. But if anything, that's sort of the only thing people hear about. And really, there are a lot of other pieces to that puzzle. So, you know, first and foremost, I think that for most of us, much of how we feel is often driven by how we think. And lots of times there are really a range of kind of very automatic negative thoughts that are kind of constantly spinning like a tape loop around, you know, our experience around sexuality, especially as we live with cancer over time, from the point of view of everything from, I'm not the same as I used to be, I don't feel sexy. I'm not sure how I'm going to talk with my partner. You know, I can't have an orgasm anymore. So, you know, it's a disaster and it's never going to get better. There's just all kinds of negative thoughts, which we may have, but they really become ingrained in almost like a habit. And it's really important, first and foremost, to be able to start to even just identify what our thoughts are about this whole topic, about, you know, all the different aspects of it. And to really be able to recognize that sometimes we make assumptions, you know, in how we talk to ourselves about this that are not true, right? That may not be true, that there really may be room there to be able to sort of experiment and move things forward that we're not sort of fully appreciating. And the other piece I'll just say again is that lots of times there's just a fair amount of distraction and avoidance. You know, we really try to go to bed at a different time from our partners. We try to avoid physically bumping up against our partners because we don't want to sort of give anyone the wrong impression or think we're kind of leading them on, because if we have a hug or an embrace, they might think that that's going to lead to something and I'm not ready for that. There's all kinds of ways in which there are all kinds of ways we distract. And we really need to start to sort of think about an alternative to that. So that may be starting to really, you know, sit with some of the sense of loss that we have if things are different than they used to be. But also, what are the possibilities for change? What are the possibilities for how we may make things different, for how we may be able to reconnect with pleasure and with a new role or script, with how we may sort of interact with our partners, for example. So again, that's that point about what's playing on your tape loop. And, you know, much of the work that we do in kind of the rehab work we do, I really think about is really about becoming aware of our thoughts without judging them, starting to be able to challenge some of those thoughts and offer an alternative. And I love the phrase, don't believe everything you think, because we think things all the time that may be true, that may not be true, which we assume are the case. And we really need to be able to sort of examine some of those thoughts. So I'll just give an example of, again, some of the kind of work around sexual recovery. We really might ask somebody to sort of kind of think, what would be a trigger? What would be something that gets you sort of activated around this? And again, it could be something you see on TV. It could be something that your partner does. It could be somebody touching you or embracing you. What might be an automatic or immediate negative thought that you have related to sexuality and intimacy? And then the most important piece of that is, how might I reframe that? What might be an alternative way of looking at that? Sometimes we might sort of frame that by saying, if a friend heard you say something like that, or if you heard a friend make a comment like that about how you feel about your body or what you think about yourself, what would you say to her, right? How would you respond? And often what we might say to a friend or what we might say to a, someone we care about is very different from how we talk to ourselves. So it gives you an idea of some of the kind of work that we do in the context of sexual health recovery. I do want to take a minute and talk a little bit about body image and self-esteem, because I think that this is something that really affects women, right? Really affects so many of us just in the culture that we live in, not only about living with cancer, and that our experience of ourselves and feeling whole is really informed by not just cancer, but our history before cancer, our assumptions about what's going to happen over time. And the reality is that especially when we live with metastatic illness, these issues often become more pressing as time goes by. And I just want to say that sometimes body image is really more problematic, depending on how we're doing physically, right? If we have a sense of for feeling a lack of vitality, if we are struggling with more physical symptoms, with changes in body integrity, it makes sense that body image is something that, you know, really shifts over time. And that first and foremost, it's so important to sort of think about taking an attitude of self-love, self-care, self-compassion, of compassion for one's body and not really judging. As a starting point. And I know that that can be challenging when we often feel so let down by our bodies. So thinking about cultivating an experience of kindness, even in the face of loss, thinking about compassion for oneself, even when we are disappointed in ourselves, is really a critical starting point. I also will really kind of comment on the fact that sexuality and sexiness and wholeness is really not driven by any body part. It is really driven by a much broader experience of ourselves as a whole person. And that it's critical to be able to invite ourselves to reimagine an experience of our whole self, right? That may be different than it was, but still very much in the context of someone who can give and receive pleasure, of someone who may well be able to be able to connect and be able to really have a sense of sexuality that may be broader, that may be richer than it was before. Meaning that it may not necessarily look the same, and yet it may actually be more expansive. You know, now that we're thinking about what it means to live fully, as fully as we can, including in around the experience of pleasure, both giving and receiving, throughout our lives. So I'm going to move to the next slide on that. Next slide. I really also want to say that I understand that often means acknowledging a sense of grief and loss. And often people say, geez, how can you talk about grief and loss if you're supposed to be helping people with sexual function? But again, speaking to the world that we live in, it is not honest and it is not real if we don't acknowledge some of that experience of grief and loss. And I know that especially in the context of living with life-limiting illness, when we don't often know how it's going to go and what the timeline is going to be. Sometimes when we think about intimacy and we literally are thinking about what that experience is of being naked, both emotionally and physically, it brings up all kinds of feelings. And that can be often one of the reasons why we sort of tend to shy away or avoid the experience of intimacy altogether. And I guess what I want to invite us to consider is that we can hold all of that in one plate. Right? There is room to be able to even experience a sense of loss or grief in a moment when we're feeling connected to someone or to ourselves, and be able to move through that, right? Be able to tolerate some of those feelings, pause, acknowledge them for what they are, and be able to continue moving through those feelings so that we can still connect with a sense of pleasure. I think that this is really important. I think that it is important to note that there are lots of normal reactions, including sadness, including frustration, including grief, when we're talking about sexuality and intimacy, and trying not to be artificial about saying, oh, I have to pretend everything is okay, is actually paradoxically one of the most important steps to being able to have a sense of sexual recovery while we're living with cancer. Okay. I'm going to pause for 1 second here and just check in. Hannah, are there any questions that have come up right now?
None that came in through the chat, but I wanted to bring up one that came in beforehand, which I think plays into what you were just talking about, which is, you know, there's so much of that, like, mental and physiological parts that are playing together. And there was a question asking if there's a suggestion for books or other resources that they could read or investigate on their own time.
Sure, yeah.
Understand that connection.
Sure. Well, happy to mention some of those at the end. You know, there, I will say, like anything, there are a number of folks who have written books about sexuality and cancer. I can't say that they are all equally good, but there is definitely, I would say good news is that there's more attention to this now more than ever, and happy to reference some specific resources at the end that people can look at. I'll say that from my starting point, you know, when I sort of think with folks about sort of what this means concretely, I do think it's important to focus on health and strength as much as possible in terms of whole body well-being. I don't think it's just about your vagina or just about the specific body part. I also accept the fact that women may not love every part of your body, our bodies, in order to be able to give and receive pleasure. And I think that's important because we live in a culture that is so focused on this sort of physicality of sexuality from the point of view of a, you know, probably 25-year-old boy or young man, that it often really is not doesn't really capture women's experience at all. And that what's important is to be as active as possible. What's important is to reconnect with sensation and to really create opportunities to start to figure out what's pleasurable, to start to figure out what can feel okay, what sensation feels relaxing or calming or arousing, rather than waiting to necessarily feel great about your body. Do you know, does that make sense, right? I think it's important to be able to sort of proceed on both tracks. I think it's important to focus on health and well-being as much as possible, but really understanding that you don't have to be like perfectly happy with everything physically in order to be able to also experiment or explore with this notion of pleasure and really connecting with sensation. So, you know, I think that what that means, sort of thinking about kind of some of the activities that you can do, both for yourself and or with a partner, basically about how you can be physically engaged with yourself. And, you know, again, that goes back to whether it's getting a vibrator, taking a vibrator out that you haven't looked at in a long time and dusting that off, or, you know, sort of even thinking about just kind of ways to sort of jumpstart the mental piece of that, right? Whether that's looking at some erotica. There's a lot of, I would say, sex positive erotica that's written by women for women. We are not necessarily talking about porn or something that we can't relate to, but really there's a lot of sort of sex positive material that I would say that is very sort of pro women, that's also sexy, you know? And so again, just sort of thinking about what we can do to kind of jumpstart some of that kind of the mental gears as well as anything physical is a really important part of, you know, taking time and intention to sort of get back to this. I also really just want to acknowledge that sometimes we have to do a piece of relationship work. It is very common in couples that things get disrupted, right? There's been a period of time where maybe people have not been sexually active, time goes by, and then it can feel awkward. And it's a funny thing, you know, where people can say, oh gosh, I'm closer to my partner than ever, but this particular piece feels kind of fraught, right? And that we're really our best friends and would do everything for each other, but yet this is something that's hard to talk about and gets kind of split off. And so, you know, what I would say is that there are a lot of strategies that we can use to really bring, to really allow couples to kind of, again, with intention, take some time, sort of commit some time to putting this on the front burner, not the back burner, and really starting with thinking about focusing on pleasure and sensuality as a starting point. And getting away from being goal-oriented. And this is really important. This is about taking the pressure off, committing to expand the repertoire of just what might feel good, of figuring out where you can kind of start to have some touch, some interaction, some communication, and very specifically acknowledging if you're not ready or you're not in a place where you even are ready to be sexually active, to take that off the table, right? To say that might not even be a place that we're going to go right now. we are communicating about that. We can't read each other's minds. We have to acknowledge that. But to have space to explore and experiment with really just reconnecting and taking small steps that we sort of go step by step, so that most importantly, people don't have to worry that when you may feel ready to try sexual activity, it's not going to hurt. It's not going to be painful. And that's where this sort of syncs up again with the vaginal health stuff, right? It doesn't matter all of the intimacy work in the world. If vaginal health is not intact and sex is going to hurt, it doesn't matter how much we do relationship work. We're going to kind of be back in that same place if you try to have sexual activity and it's painful. So again, really thinking about kind of working collaboratively with all of these pieces to make sure that when you're ready, one step at a time, you're going to set yourself up either by yourself or with your partner to have a successful experience. So that definitely often means resetting the frame. So again, starting with sort of validating where you are right now, and that can be acknowledging the changes or any losses, but noticing that we're going to see sort of start where we are, taking our time, beginning slowly, and having very specific goals and making a plan. I think that's so important. It's really easy to hear a talk like this and say, oh yeah, I want to do something. But then if we don't have a kind of a plan for what to do and how to get there, it's not so easy. And really being able to, I would say, think about this as an opportunity to expand the repertoire, right? So if this does mean expanding communication, if this does mean trying something you haven't tried before, if this does mean taking time for yourself to focus on vaginal health, to make sure that the pelvic floor is healthy, to make sure that you know what feels okay and what doesn't before you even bring a partner into the situation, I think that makes a lot of sense. So sort of last piece, I really want to acknowledge, and again, I know that especially when women are living with cancer over time, there are lots of things that people are thinking about. There are plenty of things on your checklist already. But I really want to kind of encourage people to consider that sexual health can't resolve itself when there are the things that are off track. So it's really about sort of inviting this to be something that you put some time or intention on, and you say, listen, what is it that I need to do to be able to kind of move this forward? So certainly that's about enhancing communication. If you have a partner, that's figuring out how you can create some positive experiences and allow for places where you may not agree or allow for miscommunication, but then have a way to kind of circle back and talk through some of that. That's again about healthy lifestyle and sort of being, you know, as healthy as you can in terms of nutrition and exercise. That's about compassion for oneself and sort of knowing what are the pieces you might need to work on, whether that's some of those automatic negative thoughts or whether that's sort of challenging some of those assumptions. And then really sort of getting down to what that means to promote pleasure, you know, figuring out what that would actually look like. What are the pieces that you might need to consider and what you can do to kind of start to enhance intimacy, you know? And again, I think that the intimacy piece is important because nobody's going to go from 0 to 60 in 10 seconds or 5 seconds, right? Without setting the stage. And I think that we have to set the stage. We have to sort of set things up for an experience that's going to be positive, right? So waiting several months and saying, well, we have a weekend away, we're going to try sex, is a terrible idea. You haven't had that experience in many, many months. It's not a good setup, right? So really being able to put the pieces in place so that the setup is for success is important. And really getting the support you need. And that goes back to the question, Hannah, about what are the resources? So, you know, knowing what are the issues, knowing what the information is that you need to access and getting the help you need is so important. Clearly, I will put a plug in for the sexual health program at the Dana-Farber. We have a great multidisciplinary program that includes a wonderful gynecologist, myself, another psychologist, Dr. Pozo-Caterman. We work very closely with urogynecology, endocrinology, pelvic physical therapy, just to give you a sense of what some of those resources are. Sorry, and I know I want to also just mention some of the specific other resources out there. So the Scientific Network on Female Sexual Health and Cancer, that's a big word, big phrase, but Scientific Network, Female Sexual Health and Cancer, has a wonderful website. This is an organization I'm very involved with, but we have a very excellent patient resource section with a lot of resources. Also the Dana-Farber has a sexual health page as part of our survivorship program, a lot of resources on that page. Certainly the American Cancer Society and the National Cancer Institute also have some resources as well. And I would say that, you know, Dr. Ann Katz has a very nice book on sexuality after cancer, number of books that you can now find on Amazon, of course. I think that, you know, there are several books that are out there now. You have to look around. I would probably encourage you to start looking at some of the Women Lab. That's another one. Women Lab through the University of Chicago has an amazing amount of resources that are highly vetted. So I'm delighted to say that there are more resources now than ever. And I know that we will get some of the concrete resources around moisturizers and lubes and that kind of thing connected to the website on the Embrace program. And please feel free to reach out to myself or any of us through the sexual health program at the Dana-Farber if we can be of any use or of any value to you personally. More than happy to work with anyone. So thank you for having me here today. And it's really been a pleasure to be with all of you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. This was very enlightening. I have a couple of questions that came in before. I just want to make sure I get covered before we take off for the day. The first one was, before being diagnosed with estrogen positive MBC, I use Premarin, I think is how you say it, for pain-free intercourse. I can no longer use it, and any other over-the-counter gels and lubricants just don't work. Is there an alternative?
So that is a really good question. If it sounds like this is somebody who was having some discomfort beforehand, I would say that this would be where it would be very helpful to go back to one's gynecologist or one oncology team to make sure that there may not be an alternative to a local vaginal hormone that can be used externally. If that is the case, that's just not indicated, I would say that there may be some other over-the-counter moisturizers like the hyaluronic-based moisturizers. Perhaps they may or may not have tried. But I think that there actually are a range of other products. We also know that there are other types of products. For example, there are now moisturizers that are CBD or THC formulated that can also be very helpful for getting blood flow to that tissue and relaxing muscle. I think that there actually are probably a number of other possibilities to be explored, also including thinking about pelvic floor physical therapy. So again, I don't know the specifics to that question, but when we think about what may be causing pain or discomfort, there may be a mechanical piece there, for example, around being able to relax some of the muscles and learn to be able to sort of do some expand capacity with the tissue. So I would say that, either seeing a certified menopause expert, working with the gynecologist or seeing our gynecologist here at the Dana-Farber, Dr. Sandy Falk, there really may be some room there to explore options that you haven't tried before.
And that actually flows right into the next question, which was, is there a role for CBD to reduce pain with intercourse?
So I mentioned that because, anecdotally, there's a growing body of evidence that many women find this helpful. We don't have great randomized clinical trials exploring this. So I'm not, again, sort of hyping a product that I would say we have sort of limited scientific evidence for. But the fact is, there's actually a growing suggestion that vaginal moisturizers and lubricants, CBD and or THC based can be helpful. And the reason, when you look at the sort of what would be the mechanism there, sort of combination of increasing blood flow to that tissue and relaxing, helping women relax pelvic floor muscles. So certainly anecdotally, I've talked with women who have found these products very helpful. Again, not promoting them per se, but it is something that women are using. Again, I would say the most important thing is to make sure you know what the ingredients are in the product. So I think it's important that if you're going to get a product like that, you want to go to a dispensary that is reputable. You want to know what the products are, what the ingredients are, and you want to get something that is of high quality in nature.
Great. Thank you so much. And then the final question that's come in, I'm just going to read it right from the screen so I can misinterpret. But it says, thank you for this expansive presentation and acknowledgement of how this work centers around very gendered parts of the body. In what ways have you seen this work be affirming for transgender and or non-binary people?
So I really want to just say and appreciate that obviously my talk today, was sort of more traditionally focused on, you know, the notion of sort of women with living with breast cancer. I think that for folks that are transgender, non-binary, many of the issues are the same, right? In that, obviously, you know, the focus around figuring out what is pleasurable, the focus on figuring, you know, if a person has a vagina, it is important to make sure that vaginal health is intact so that we are decreasing discomfort, we are decreasing pain with or without sexual activity. I very much appreciate the question because I think it's important to be as inclusive as possible around sort of making sure that regardless of sexual orientation, gender orientation, that people feel that the goal here is to one, figure out for themselves what is distressing, what is problematic, and to figure out an action plan to address those issues. I think certainly it is critically important to be able to communicate with your partner, right? I think that it is critically important to figure out how to feel comfortable in your body and to figure out if there is something that is painful or distressing, what we can do to address those problems directly. So I would say that the many of the same dynamics apply. Also very much also appreciating that, a talk like this may need to be more expansive in the context of it being very much directed around trans-binary or non-binary folks. And I appreciate the sensibility to that issue. Thank you.
Yeah, great. Great questions. Thank you so much from all the participants who provided questions for us today. And thank you so much, Dr. Bober. This was just wonderful. I know I learned a lot, took some notes during the presentation. So really appreciate you being here. And I just want to let everyone know who's listening still that this session has been recorded and it will be placed on the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute Embrace webpage at a time to come. But thank you all for being here. I really appreciate it. And I hope you guys have a great day.
Nice to see you.